So that's all our housekeeping done. And so now I'd just like to finally mention that we've got some videos within the session today. So some of those can be a bit louder, some can be a bit quieter than expected. So please just do adjust your own audio so you have a great listener experience. And then now I'd like to move on and welcome our first speaker, which is our CEO at Movement to Work, Sam Olsen.
Thank you, Kathryn, and thank you so much, everyone, for joining us. A huge, big, warm welcome. Such a shame, as Kathryn said, that we can't all be together in person and be giving you an opportunity to meet face to face and have coffee together. Maybe even a croissant or two. Remember those days when we were able to do that? But hopefully later in the year. So for this occasion, I'd really encourage you today to share your name, where you're from, and what you'd like to get out of the next hour or so with us, just so that people can start to interact with each other and you all know who's here this morning. We really do appreciate your time for being with us today virtually and really hope that you enjoy what we've put together. We're going to be challenging you to think about what you can do differently in your leadership roles to create youth employment opportunities. We've got a few new faces here today. So for those of you who don't know much about Movement to Work, post the last financial crisis in 2013, Movement to Work was born out of a commitment made by a small collective of businesses and civil servants to fix the growing youth and employment problem in the UK. These business leaders, many of whom are still on our steering group today, took responsibility by aiming to break that cycle of no experience, no job that so many young people face, particularly those who've experienced challenging backgrounds, by providing great opportunities for young people to grow their confidence and boost their skills, aiming to level up that playing field for young people aged 16 to 30 who are facing barriers to work. The results, interestingly though, haven't just benefited the young people by supporting them into work, but also it's created fantastic opportunities for businesses to develop diverse talent pipelines and to bring to life a renewed sense of purpose for those organisations and its people. So let's flash forward to today, and amidst another global crisis, we have now sadly got a record number of young people out of employment who haven't had an opportunity in the last 12 to 18 months to work in those traditional early career sectors, such as retail and hospitality, that so many of us in our younger years got our first job experiences in. Many of the young people we support are in the communities hardest hit by the pandemic. Some have had to shield for over 12 months. Those hardest hit who struggled pre-COVID are now struggling so much more. The moral case for change for us has never been greater. So I'm going to challenge you today to plan to seek those young people out to make them your next hires. We need to take the extra step of considering character and attitude over neat CVs. We need to look for potential and be prepared to develop it. As a movement funded by our steering group, we will support you to design and implement brilliant youth employability programmes, help to unlock the right government-funded schemes to support your efforts and promote best practice and inspire high standards so that young people who engage in our schemes are given the best possible chance of success. With hundreds of organisational members now, Movement to Work has helped to deliver over 100,000 work placements made possible by employers, charities and government working together. Collectively, we've provided young people with diverse work experience opportunities, ranging from hospitality through to engineering, with regional hubs working in London, the Midlands, North East and North West, really making a difference nationwide. I'm delighted today that we're focusing specifically on the Midlands. This is where I went to school and where I started my career, in an aluminium and stainless steel stockholder of all places. There is such a rich talent in this region, but there are also large groups of young people who really need our support and our inspiration. So today, as leaders, listen and be inspired. Think about how we can support you to diversify your talent, engage and have a positive impact in your communities. I'll be talking later about the ways we can continue to work together to help young people. But until then, I really hope you enjoy this session, create a bit of chat, tell people what you want out of today, and I look forward to reading all about it and speaking to you at the end. Enjoy the session. Back over to Kathryn.
Thanks very much, Sam. That's great. So now we're moving to the first session as part of our insights section of the event. And with that, I'm delighted to introduce our next speaker, which is Claire Hatton, the head of skills delivery at the West Mids Combined Authority. So over to you, Claire.
Thank you, Kathryn, and morning, everybody. I'm just going to start by playing you a very short video, I hope.
Dear West Midlands, today I read the commitments of the industrial strategy of the West Midlands Combined Authority. And it gave me answers, but it gave me questions too. Do you know what I mean? Does it mean that we will grow more oaks from our acorns? And that even the ones that land in the shade can grow into the light? We've always seen the importance of our oaks, but we can't neglect their origin. Will this mean that we will teach and train a generation to build a new future, rather than to meet and be measured by an age standard? Can we equip our people to equip each other rather than falling into the trap of the opposite? Is this region going to tread old turf or plan new paths? The foundation is strong. Now it's time to build, not just houses, but communities. Stronger than bulls, from Coventry to Wolves, that no amount of huffing and puffing could destroy. Can the home of the Peaky Blinders and Citizen Khan become a stage, like the Belgrade, the Rep, and the Grand? Can you take your place in that spotlight? With a soon-to-be city of culture, with a cathedral that rose from the ashes like the saviour that it celebrates rose, like a jewel in the West Midlands crown, each day is brighter. HS2 is not a final destination, it's a new beginning. Can these West Midlands be the first stop on a journey towards national development? Can the minds and hands of the children who can see the tracks from their bedroom window build a route to a new future? Can we build with, for, and from each other? Can Wolverhampton, Coventry, and Birmingham become the greatest trio since Ron, Harry, and Hermione? Surely, like the BG brothers, the depth of our love is the key to staying alive in these unsure times. Could it be that in a place where the makers have always made, not everything should change, but these hands and their trades will ensure nothing is the same? How do you build tomorrow anyway? With a strong team, one piece at a time, and everyone working for the same outcome. Does it mean the quality of our energy generation could be as high as the energy at the Molyneux on a Saturday afternoon? Stored like the energy being built up in Coventry, the 2021 city of culture, and transmitted like passengers to Brum by a high-speed rail, just desperate to be involved. I'm reaching out to you now. Like Kat Cochran calling out to her dearest Scotland, I'm reaching out in hope that you, the future of this great place, can tell me what you want that future to look like. I'm hoping you can tell me what it means. Write it for me. sing it to me, share it with me. Dear West Midlands, I'm listening.
Powerful stuff from Casey Bailey, and I think that really sums up a lot of us, what our challenges are in the region. You can move my slides on to challenges. That'd be fab. Thank you. Combined Authority, recently re-elected mayor, who you'll be hearing from later. Our challenges for us over the next few years: delivering good jobs, supporting thriving places and communities. You heard Casey talk about those young people that can see the train tracks of HS2. If we bring all the investment to the West Midlands, and yet those people who live by the side of where that track is going to be don't benefit from those economic gains in the region, then we've kind of failed. We've got a big challenge around carbon neutrality and net zero, and bringing our green ambitions to life and creating good green jobs. And for us as a region, levelling up economically, spatially, health inequalities wise, and outward, us against other regions. And probably what we're here to talk about today, but preventing a lost generation. If you could move on for me. Just a few numbers for you. Pre-pandemic, across the West Midlands, 22,000 young people unemployed in our region. Now that's shockingly high at the best of times. It now stands at 42,000. That's 42,000 young people without a place in college, potentially without a job, that we need to do something about. And 86% increase in unemployment overall in the region. One in four jobs below the real living wage in our region, and a differential of 9 years in life expectancy in different places across the region. We have to do better and we have to do more. You can move on for me. I think we've been doing a little bit of reflecting as we've been through mayoral elections and coming out of pandemic, and hopefully starting to be able to move forward. And our report card in the region, what would we say about our work in young people? We'd say the scale of the challenge remains stubbornly high for us, that there's some good progress happening, there's some good alignment of partner activity, there's some great partnership activity across the West Midlands. You'll hear from Helene and her team shortly, great joint working between organisations, so many people committed to this agenda. But quite frankly, it's not rapid enough and it's not happening at the scale we need. We've had a fabulous scheme in Kickstart, but we don't have the numbers of opportunities for young people we would like in this region to be able to help tackle that horrible number of 42,000 apprenticeships. Apprenticeship starts are down, and shockingly down for young people. Apprenticeship numbers are being held up by those over 25 in the professional sectors. The number of opportunities are reducing and reducing for young people. We have fabulous youth hubs opening across our region, but lots of our services are still fragmented at the moment. And we have loads of great initiatives, but we're really still scratching the surface. So if we can move on, just by way of setting the scene today, our ask is opportunities. We need opportunities in significant numbers for young people, and whatever employers can do, whether that's helping with upskilling opportunities through things like Kickstart, or whether that's new employment opportunities, jobs, apprenticeships. We do need your support and your help in making a difference to that number and making a difference to the lives of the young people in our region. Thank you.
Thanks, Claire. That's some really great insights there to take away, and I'll be looking forward to hearing more from Claire in the panel discussion later on. We're now going to move on to our impact session, and I'm now going to hand over to Helene Dearn, who's the Group Director of the West Midlands for the Department for Work and Pensions. For those of you who don't know, the DWP work really closely with us, and their Director General, Debbie Alders, on our steering group too. So real great support there and collaboration, and delighted to have Helene here today. So over to you, Helene.
Good morning. Can everybody hear me?
Yep, sound great.
Lovely. So thank you, first of all, for the invite to join your conference today. As Kathryn says, my name is Helene Dearn. I'm the Group Director with responsibility for DWP services across West Midlands and the wider shires. And I've worked for DWP for quite a long time, and I'm going to talk to you a little bit today about some of the great programmes and opportunities that we are looking to grow and develop with your help and support over the coming days and weeks to try to support more of our young people into work. That video we've just watched was massively powerful as a West Midlands resident, born and bred, to hear those words, to recognise all of those locations and that passion in the young people of the West Midlands has just sort of made me go, oh. But, you know, I think we all need to think today about the scale of the challenge that presents us. Movement to Work is part of the wider DWP offer. I lead on that nationally for the department. And we've invested a lot of time over the last year in understanding how we can deliver movement to work in different ways. And I'm really proud of some of the digital offers that we now give to young people to understand the world of work, particularly around civil service vacancies. And you'll hear a little bit later from one of our customers who has benefited from that movement to work experience. Over the last year, DWP has gone through, as I'm sure all of your organisations have, its most challenging year. And just a year ago, I would have been sitting here talking to my people about how do we ensure that families that found themselves out of work in furlough were getting financial support to see them through those early weeks and months of the pandemic. And our whole workforce shifted and pivoted to making sure that happened. And for the first time in a long time, DWP were able and recognised for our skill in doing that. But since the autumn, our challenge has been very, very different. And we've had to switch our attention and our thoughts towards how do we ensure that the government's plan for jobs really comes alive and starts to support a lot of those customers into work. Plan for Jobs has got a number of items entailed within it. You know, it's got significant financial backing to come later in the year, the Restart Programme. But we are already heavily invested in delivering job finding support, which is around helping customers newly unemployed understand how the labour market works currently. We are heavily invested in the SWAP programme, which we deliver in collaboration with many of you, that helps our customers get ready for job interviews, get ready to move sectors. Our JETS programme, which is about the more longer term unemployed and how we help them. But today I really want to concentrate on Kickstart and really where DWP is investing heavily in support for young people. Can we go back a slide, please? So our current DWP youth offer has evolved significantly in the last few months. We now run the youth employment programme for every new unemployed young person who comes through the universal credit doorway. We'll get a 13-week intensive period of support with a named work coach that talks to them about where are you at in your job search, what more help do you need, what other partners and providers can we signpost you to that's really going to get you ready for employment. We've established a number of youth hubs with dedicated work coaches across our region. 10 in total are earmarked and growing as we speak. I'm very proud of the work that we're doing in collaboration with the Combined Authority and a range of partners to make sure those youth hubs offer really dedicated support to those young people who need a little bit more help, who need us to help them overcome specific barriers before they are ready for the world of work. And we're also employing youth employability coaches in all of our job centres now, who really will go the extra mile for those that are furthest away from employment. We fully understand that not every young person will be ready to take a job straight away, but how we build them back towards that is the role of the youth employability work coach. We've already recruited over 1,400 new work coaches in the West Midlands and the wider shires. That's doubled the amount of work coaches that I have in my job centres. 10 youth hubs, as I've already mentioned, and 50 of those youth employability coaches. But there is more to come. We are really heavily investing in our work coaches in understanding the needs of their customers and also giving them time to invest with that in one-to-one relationship. But the jewel in the crown for us at the moment is Kickstart. This program will provide job placements for young people paid at the national minimum wage for 6 months with employers, with third sector providers, delivered through employers directly, delivered through gateways. It is a massive, massive, massive scheme that the government has invested billions of pounds in. Can we move on to the next slide? So across the West Midlands, as Claire has already said, we've seen, you know, a massive shift in the number of young people that are claiming universal credit at the moment. Those figures move daily, but you can't get away from the fact that the increase is well over 80% on where it was at this time last year. We have an ambition to try and place 24,000 young people into a kickstart role in the West Midlands between now and the end of December. That is one hell of a challenge, but I believe it is a great opportunity to actually turn the tide for our young people across the West Midlands about their future and the opportunities that are there for them. Unemployment was already stubbornly high for young people in our region before the pandemic. It has just got even tougher for them. So my aim would always be to make sure that the customers in my job centres and in my offices get access to their fair share of that £2 billion worth of funding, and we find and secure 24,000 job placements for young people on UC today. But to do that, I'm going to need around 30,000 vacancies. We're currently running at around 9,000. So as you can see, the scale and the pace in which we've got to move to that scale is critical. And today I'm really hoping that through my input, through what you hear from the rest of the speakers, and through when we get a chance to talk in the Q&A a little bit later, you'll feel that Kickstart is something that your organisation, if not already involved in, can become even more involved in. Because the only way we will deliver this is in partnership with employers, our third sector, everybody out there on this call and in the wider labour market, coming together and wrapping round your skill and belief in the future of the young people of the West Midlands. So I'm hoping that some of you are already avidly writing down the inbox at the bottom there. But if you or your organisation would like to know more about Kickstart, would like to get more involved, or would like to increase the number of placements that you're already offering, then please use the inbox as I've detailed there, inquiries.westmidskickstart@dwp.gov.uk, and one of my team will be in touch with you by return to see how we can help you facilitate those placements. Thank you very much for listening.
Thanks very much, Helene. That's great. So we're looking forward to hearing more in the panel discussion. But now moving on to Richard Rigby, who's the head of policy and public affairs at the Prince's Trust. And Richard's going to give us a brief overview of a recent research report from the Learning and Work Institute and the Prince's Trust that was supported by HSBC, which really shows the current youth jobs crisis that's set to cost the UK economy around £7 billion next year. So we work really closely with Prince's Trust at Movement to Work. So I'm really excited to welcome Richard today. So whenever you're ready, Richard.
Thanks, Kathryn, and thanks very much for the invitation. I'll jump right in because I think what we wanted to accomplish is this research project was pretty extensive, but so I can't do it all justice today, but I'll take you on a whistle-stop tour of it. The impact of the pandemic to date on young people's employment is quite well documented. We wanted to add to that, but we also, I think, wanted to enter perhaps the dangerous game of making predictions about where the economy and young people's prospects might be going from here. So let's go into that now. Next slide. So the key element of this is that young people have not, I suppose, all been in this together in terms of the impact on their employment. We looked at the percentage reduction in hours worked between different groups of young people. And as you can see, I mean, everyone was down on average. But for example, if you're a young graduate already working in a professional occupation, there's a good chance your work has been relatively unaffected compared to others. On this slide, you can see a little bit of the, at the top, the change difference between regions. London in the southeast, West Midlands, you can see also quite high up the chart there. So some reasons for this. I mean, London is particularly affected by lack of tourism, hospitality, theatres, arts. And at the bottom, I think you see, so the Northeast, for example, has seen the lowest reduction, but that's partly due to it has the highest proportion of public sector employment, which has definitely been significantly less affected than private sector employment over the pandemic. You can see there that gender is quite similar, but there's a big difference in terms of ethnicity, with Black young people experiencing a significant reduction in hours worked compared to, say, white young people. Some of that can be explained by the regions that have been affected. So you can see, if you look at Wales and North East at the bottom there, they're not particularly ethnically diverse areas, which explains some of the extent of the ethnicity difference there, but I think not all of it for sure. Next slide, please. And then qualifications. This is pretty significant. So if you've got a degree, chances are you've only experienced a 7% fall in hours, compared to if you've got no qualifications, a third drop in hours worked. So a significant story there. So that this is a, and there's a little bit about occupations and sectors there, but I'll touch more on those in a second. Next slide, please. And this is now looking forward. Based on Office of Budget Responsibility, who do the official government forecasts. And these are forecasts about where youth unemployment could be heading. The assumptions are based on rapid vaccine rollout, roadmap success, rebound in consumers spending, business investment, and then a slight slowdown heading into winter. But assumes a level of youth unemployment compared to the overall. And this is what these predictions brought. So you can see that next year, 2021, is forecast to be the highest. Number of reasons for that. The job retention scheme, of course, is still running to some degree until September, finishes on the 1st of October. Currently 800,000 young people on that who need to come out, find jobs at the same time that we get a lot of education leavers coming, looking for jobs towards the end of this year. And then those who have been significantly affected by the pandemic, we expect to be with long-term unemployment or youth unemployment peaking next year. I'll go to the next slide now. We did some costing of this with Learning and Work Institute. So there are various costs here, which if you're looking to lobby the Treasury or anyone like that, and various costs in terms of lost national output, and young people not being paid, less wages being paid, less tax, more benefits, but also critically, scarring effects on young people's long-term ability to thrive and be in work. Next slide, please. And now we're looking at the longer term trends, which is what we really wanted to do with this research. There's a lot more in the full report, but this looks at where we are in normal times, proportion of young people employed in each industry. You can see at the top of this slide that retail, hospitality, right at the top of there, streets ahead of some other sectors. They are two of the three sectors where young people are more proportionally more likely to be employed. The other one is arts, entertainment, and recreation down towards the bottom there, is where the orange lines are bigger than the blue lines. So that's the normal situation. Now, if we look ahead in the next slide, we look at which sectors are likely to be where employment demand is going to be changing in the future. Those three sectors that I mentioned, where young people are proportionally more likely to be employed, are those where demand for employees is likely to fall. So especially, as you can see at the bottom there, wholesale and retail trade, which is the largest employer of young people, set to experience a fall in demand. That's not to say that retail still won't be the largest employer of young people, but proportionally, there'll be less opportunities for young people in those industries. So will other industries step up, or will young people find it harder to find jobs, is a question going forward. And there's a similar impact when looking at occupations, which I won't go into now. Next slide, please. Then qualifications are going to become increasingly important. Very clear trend in this slide, but I think this just means that those young people who struggle at school are going to find it, and it particularly hard to find employment in the longer term. So there's a lot to do with getting young people back into education, getting them to higher qualifications, but really we need to find routes into employment for those who school didn't work for. Next slide, please. Finish on a bit of a positive here, that net zero is an opportunity. So over a third of employers think that the UK's transition to a net zero economy will help create jobs for young people in their sector. On the next slide, you see this is quite, there's a big difference by sector. The most optimistic sectors by far are construction, IT and telecoms, but you wouldn't expect some sectors to see this as an opportunity. For example, hospitality is, I think, sees it as the sector that sees it at least as an opportunity. Interestingly, for movement to work, it's large employers who are predominantly likely to see it as an opportunity. So that's another positive, I think, for the work that movement to work and its partners can do. So I'll finish there, but in summary, I think the message from this research is that as much as we'd like to see and hope to see a bit of a summer bounce in employment prospects for young people over the next few months as hospitality and sectors reopen, as we go into autumn and winter, the likelihood is, according to official forecasts, that the peak of youth unemployment might not be till later this year and be particularly big next year. And then, although we hope to recover, long-term changes to the economy point to lower youth employment, which means that the work of Movement to Work and its partners is particularly important over the next few years. Thank you.
Thanks, Richard. So some really interesting, but obviously really worrying findings there that, you know, we can all reflect on and think about how we can play a part in really helping tackle some of these challenges. So we're moving now to our Inspire section for the session, and we've got some great case studies we want to share with you today. One from a business and one from a young person. So first up, we're going to hear from Heather Graham, who's Employability Programme Specialist at Marks & Spencers, who sent in this pre-recorded message, and then her colleague is going to join us on the panel later.
Hi everyone, I'm Heather Graham and I'm the Employment Programme Specialist here at Marks & Spencer. At M&S we are hugely committed and passionate for helping various individuals from different disadvantaged groups and backgrounds into work. However, hopefully what this short update will do will help bring to life what we do in particular for our younger generation of people who we know have been disproportionately affected by the pandemic. M&S is and always has been hugely passionate for helping support the younger generation gain work experience. We have a long-standing relationship with the Prince's Trust that we greatly value, and we've worked closely together for the last 16 years helping over 9,000 young people gain access to work. The main employability programme that we offer is called Marks and Start. Marks and Start is a four-week work placement programme that we run mainly across our shops. The Prince's Trust and M&S galvanise interest from suitable young people for our programme, and we host a selection day. If they're successful at that selection day, then they enter onto a four-week work placement programme in one of our M&S stores. This is where they'll receive an induction from Prince's Trust and M&S. They'll attend various employability skills workshops. They'll get a detailed four-week learning plan so that they can get stuck into learning the practical skills of being in a shop. And we match them up with an M&S buddy who they can shadow for the programme. At the end of the 4 weeks, if the young person has demonstrated the required skills and behaviours, the line manager will sign them off using the accreditation record. Host a fabulous celebration day for all participants where lots of people like to attend, including their buddies. And it's great because we get to hear about what they've enjoyed about the programme and also, really importantly, what they've learned during their time. Marks and Start is a formula that works for our business, and I'm sure other employers will find formulas that work for theirs too. It works for us because it's operationally simplistic, which it needs to be to work in our stores. It's fairly short and easy to implement without a huge amount of resource. The young people learn the actual skills, values, behaviours of an M&S colleague, so if they impress, then they absolutely help to fill our recruitment needs. And it relies on having M&S colleagues who are passionate about helping others, which fortunately for us, there are many willing volunteers who want to act as buddies and share with the young people everything they know. Our tried and tested formula, unfortunately, wasn't going to work last year with the pandemic. And as such, M&S, along with the Prince's Trust, took the joint decision to pause the programme last March to ensure the safety of our colleagues, customers and participants. However, the pandemic, as we know, magnified the barriers that young people face for getting into work. So we felt we couldn't just continue to pause the programme and needed to think about how we could deliver it differently. I'm proud to say, with a very quick turnaround, we were able to reimagine the programme and create a blended digital offer that allowed us to deliver both the selection day and their workshops virtually, and still allowed them to learn the practical skills with their colleagues in store. We also ensured a strong focus on their mental well-being and safety to help the young people feel supported when coming back into the workplace. I'm delighted to say that from October we delivered 350 placements for young people across over 100 stores, and actually 6% of those placements were located within the West Midlands area. Also during last summer, we heard about the government initiative Kickstart and knew that we wanted to support with this. We are running Kickstart placements for 360 young people across two cohorts. We launched our first cohort of 180 young people just a few weeks ago, and our second programme will start in July. Again, we worked in partnership with the Prince's Trust to develop a programme that offered wraparound support to our young colleagues. So they've attended an interview skills workshop before their interviews. We've looked at our existing M&S induction and elevated that from 3 days to 8 days, so they feel really confident before hitting the shop floor. Each young person has a buddy, and we've managed to train 180 buddies prior to the programme starting. We've designed bespoke digital learning modules that will teach them work skills for now and for the future. We're asking them to rotate across all departments within our shop, so they'll learn about all bits of the business. They're attending various employability skills workshops and one-to-ones with the Prince's Trust. And we're looking to protect 20% of their time purely for learning, so that they can work through their individual learning logs and toolkits. And then finally, we also want to make sure we do a really good job of signposting other development programmes and career opportunities that we have across our business. Feedback so far has been amazing. They've loved their induction to M&S, and they've hugely appreciated their M&S goodie bag that the business were more than willing to provide. And there's lots of tasty treats in here, so we're obviously hoping to hook them early on some of their M&S faves. The store teams have really gone above and beyond with their inductions, and there is real hype and energy for having them in our business. This group of young people are so eager to help and support the next intake, which starts in July. And I think this is truly fantastic. When we have people that enter via employability schemes, it creates this real ripple effect where they want to help and support the next wave of individuals that come through. We're also reviewing each stage as well, so we can hopefully make the next one even better. We are genuinely excited about this year in the space of employability. There's so much opportunity. We're already thinking about launching a Marks and Start programme for 500 places in the autumn, and we're thinking about how we can innovate the content and the design of that programme so we can better equip the young people with the experience and the skills that they need to help improve their future prospects for work. We're also thinking about how do we get better at converting our work placement experiences into further career paths for our younger people. And we've got lots of ideas and ways of where we think that we can measure this through our early careers programme. Finally, we're also thinking about how do we explore the traineeships and sector-based work academy space. And we're thinking about actually how do we look to increase or further increase our diversity across our business through these schemes. All that's left to say is a massive thank you to Movement to Work for hosting this event. It's been brilliant, but also a huge thank you from us here at M&S. You have been instrumental in steering our thinking in this space, and you're always giving us lots of ideas and inspiration on how we can do even more. So thank you. Thanks, everyone.
And thanks to Marks and Spencers for sharing that great video, really inspiring what they're doing, their programmes. So hopefully it's giving you some food for thought. Next, we're going to hear from a fabulous young speaker, Hope Lloyd, who has been through one of the Movement to Work programmes at the Department for Work and Pensions and now moved on to a successful career with them. So let's hear about her journey into work.
My name is Hope Lloyd, and I'm happy to say that I've just accepted an offer to be a caseload worker for the Department of Work and Pensions located in Wolverhampton. Most of my job life, I've been hopping from job to job that have little to no progression, whether that's a 0-hour contract to a Christmas temp job. However, the more jobs I worked, the more disconnected I felt to my dreams and what I actually believe in and want to do. Something that I do quite a lot in my spare time is fundraise. This year, so far, in 2021, I have raised over £2,400 for a mental health charity called Tiny Changes that are based in Scotland. Using my own personal skills, I have designed and illustrated various photographs of Scottish musicians into prints and donated the money to charity. And speaking to my work coach, it made me realise that helping people is what I enjoy doing and what I should be doing as a job. My work coach made me realise that I have a lot to offer and that she introduced me into the Movement to Work scheme in order to gain more experience and develop the skills that I have in order to work towards something that I really want to do. Therefore, I joined the soonest Movement to Work course and I really enjoyed it. I learned about the Kickstart programme and how much the government is actually doing to help young people get employment, and not only just employment, but to help them discover what they are really passionate about. Another thing that I learned about was Prince's Trust, which is an enterprise programme for young people who want to be self-employed. Movement to Work isn't just about getting yourself a standard employment. It can also be a way of showing you how to be self-employed. I personally have enrolled into Prince's Trust Scheme, and after doing the 2-day course, I am now moving forward to create my own illustration business called Create Hope, which I will do alongside working for the DWP, which I have learned they are very supportive of. I am so grateful for the opportunity I was given, because it's really boosted my confidence and it's shown me that I'm worthy. Movement to Work programmes allow people to understand careers rather than just seeing a simple advert on the internet. You get to talk to the people that actually work the jobs. So then you have an insight rather than just reading a description. You have a physical working person telling you about what they do on a day-to-day business basis and what they enjoy. Another good thing about this is that it gives you the ability to move forward and get a job like I have. My advice to fellow young people who are trying to get into work would be to be honest with yourself, to thoroughly talk to your work coach, and also to be honest with them. It's okay to feel like you're not getting anywhere, because honestly, most of us feel like that. I know I have. And there is always a better option. By talking to your work coach, it allows them to enroll you into courses that they know would be beneficial for your life, such as the Movement to Work scheme. And my advice to the employers would be that you should really consider the Kickstart programs, because they really help young people who are trying to move forward in their life, that are trying so hard to get into that career that they've dreamed of. And that might be because they want to get their own house, because they want to move forward in life, because they have their own goals. And if they're anything like me, we work hard because we're a passionate generation. I'm thoroughly excited to start my new career path with the DWP. I would like to thank Universal Credit, my job coaches, and the Movement to Work scheme for this opportunity to move forward in my life. Thank you. And remember, young people work. Hello.
What an amazing video from Hope, and you know, congratulations to her and all the young people that helped her get where she is. We're really passionate about wellbeing at Movement to Work, and so we're going to give you a really short break to give you a chance to stretch your legs and just take a moment. You don't need to log off. We're going to be back in a few minutes. If you can be back for 11:20, because our extra special guest is going to be coming, which is the newly re-elected Mayor of the West Midlands, Andy Streets, with a special message for us. So we'll join back at 11:20. Don't log off. See you soon. Welcome back, everybody. I hope you enjoyed that quick break. I'm now really pleased to welcome our newly re-elected Mayor of the West Midlands, Andy Streets, and he's going to share some of his thoughts with us today. So over to you, Andy.
Thank you very much indeed, Kathryn, and thank you very much for letting me have this opportunity so soon into the new term. I'm not going to take you long because I know you've had some brilliant presentations already, which have got the guts, and in a sense what I wanted to say should have come right at the beginning, and I'm sorry the diary didn't allow me to do that, but just a few thoughts that hopefully will be relevant. First thing to say, of course, is a huge thank you to Movement for Work to Work for bringing this occasion together. I've seen their work over the last few years, and it's a very practical approach to particularly getting young people into new opportunities, so thank you for what you're doing. The next thing to do, of course, is to acknowledge the scale of the challenge that we face. And I know that in Claire's presentation, she was incredibly honest about that and the impact the pandemic has had upon the region. And we've seen a big increase, not out of line with what's happened in other areas of the country, but a big increase in youth unemployment over the last 15 months. So it is absolutely critical that we pull every single lever that we've got to make sure young people get opportunities as quickly as possible. And the reason I say that with such passion in my voice is we've seen in my generation, frankly, young people in the West Midlands in the 80s, that if unemployment became endemic, then it led to all sorts of other issues that frankly we thought we'd put behind us, but actually we must act quickly to make sure this time around we're much more decisive in dealing with this before it becomes endemic. So we've set ourselves a challenge in my manifesto, my plan for this next mayoral term of 100,000 jobs over the next 2 years. The good thing is, if you look at the detail of the numbers coming out from DWP, for example, at the moment, we can see that it looks as though we have passed the bottom of the trough and we're just beginning to improve. So the timing is good and we've got lots of detailed plans behind that 100,000 numbers, which sectors, which businesses are actually going to generate those opportunities. So it's really good that we've got that opportunity. And indeed, you have heard about some of the options that there are for businesses, and I know there's lots of businesses on the call, to contribute to that. So whether it be what the government are doing around Kickstart, for example, what we're doing around sector-based work academies, so important, that work with our colleges, what's being done, for example, around the National Retraining Fund that we're piloting on, for example, in digital. There are so many different opportunities here and ways that we can give opportunities to our young people. Then hopefully you've also been told that our work around the youth platform and the youth hubs, although they've been slightly contained by the whole COVID situation, it actually gives a method by which people can understand what I know is sometimes a bewildering set of options. So the simple message is there are so many opportunities there. And of course, they're focused in some of the newer areas of our economy. So that's why we're doing so much work on getting people trained for the digital economy. Why there are those big opportunities in healthcare, one of the big growing areas. And of course, why we're also thinking about the new green jobs. And just to pick out two lovely examples of where we've made this practical, the money we've just received from government to getting people started training in the skills needed for retrofitting to make our homes more environmentally conscious, lowering energy use. And another great example, the work we're doing with Wolverhampton College on training young people into the skills required for electric vehicle maintenance. So really practical examples of where those new green skills are already giving jobs, but the new economy opportunities there. And then the last thing I would say then is really just a very almost naked plea to the employers on the call. If you have got an opportunity, but do not know quite how to sort of get that into the form where a young person can come into you, please, there's so many avenues for help. Obviously, DWP will help, but also any member of the WMCA skills team would be able to help you in terms of converting that. Or, of course, the gateway organisations. If you're thinking about Kickstart, just contact your local Chamber of Commerce or your local council in many cases. Actually, everybody's there to try to help you convert your thinking about what you could do for a young person into one of these schemes or opportunities. And we're frankly going to need everyone across the West Midlands to come together to make a big, big dent in those numbers. But more importantly, to give a young person a brilliant start in life. And you all know there's nothing more important than you can do is just sow some trust, some faith in somebody. And my great belief is when that happens, young people always respond with incredible ingenuity and passion. And you never regret taking that risk on a young person. So Kathryn, that's all I wanted to say to try to pull it, some of the presentations you've had together and hopefully encourage people to step forward with opportunities.
That's great, thanks Andy. And thank you for joining us today. Great to hear your thoughts. So I'm now delighted to move on to our panel. So my colleague, Simon Beckman, who's the Movement to Work Head of Regional Development in the Northwest, is going to chair our panel today and some of the great speakers that you've already heard from today. So over to you, Simon.
Thank you, Kathryn. Hi, everybody. As Kathryn says, I'm Simon Beckman, I'm the Head of Regional Development in the Northwest. I'll be chairing the panel today, and I'd like to just start by quickly welcoming today's panelists who we have, and I'll start with Claire Hatton, who is Head of Skills Delivery at the West Midlands Combined Authority. We have Helene Dearn, who you've heard from as well, as the Group Director of the West Midlands DWP. we welcome back Richard Rigby, Head of Policy and Public Affairs at the Prince's Trust. And a lady you've not heard from as yet, Louise Tredwen, who is an HR talent partner at Marks & Spencer. So welcome to you all, and thank you so much for taking part in this discussion. And without further ado, we'll start with the first question. And this one is for you, Claire. From an employer perspective, how do you navigate through the funding system that's out there, and how could an employer get support?
Yeah, really good question, because it is incredibly complex in lots of ways. But as Andy alluded to, there are organisations there to help you. DWP, ourselves, local authorities, growth hubs, we don't deliver lots of those programs ourselves, so we can be a little bit impartial about how we give you the advice, and we can then try to help navigate for employers to say. And I don't think it starts with what the funding program is actually. I think it starts with your business and what your business needs are and what you might be able to do to help a young person or an adult, actually, you know, what will work in your business. And then anybody in those type of organisations will be able to say, well, here's some options for you, and here's the way to, you know, navigate through it. I would say that lots of providers as well do a great job in terms of giving advice. But if any employer feels they're being just sold one product or being pushed down a particular route without being given options, then I'd move on and talk to somebody else. But definitely DWP, ourselves, local authorities, LEPs, all of us chambers, in terms of some impartial advice to be able to help navigate and signpost.
Wonderful. Thank you very much indeed. Some great advice there. Just moving over then to Helene, I can come to you with the next question. And this is around the Kickstart programme. So given that the current Kickstart timelines are looking to have the last people in place by the end of this year, would you still say it's still worth employees engaging with the scheme at this stage?
Oh, I totally believe that it's worth employers engaging at this stage. We still have time. We still have some runway in which to identify the vacancy opportunities, build the right vacancy spec, get that out with our work coaches, and place young people at any time between now and the end of this calendar year, which would then see that opportunity run into the first 6 months of 2022. We know 2022 is a massive year for our region with the Commonwealth Games coming. So I really want to make sure we have opportunities running right the way through to the end of this year that we can maximise on into next year and really give our young people in this region the opportunity to get the very best benefits that we can out of the Kickstart programme. So, yes, I do think it is definitely worth employers engaging with us now and over the coming weeks to build vacancies that may not come live until the autumn.
Okay, no, that's fantastic. And just to follow up on that, what would you say are the ways that, say, Movement to Work partners and other organisations with Kickstart opportunities out there can perhaps influence work coaches to make an appropriate level of referrals? Is there anything that they can do?
There is, definitely. So what we've seen so far is the vacancies that are most appealing or that get filled quickest are the ones where an employer has really given some consideration to the type of person they're looking for, but also the fact that that person may not be absolutely spot on perfect from day one. So there may be some key criteria that the employer is looking for. And, you know, we fully understand that. But, you know, you may be not always going to get a fully rounded candidate. So where the employer has given some consideration to that job spec, you know, maybe not just taking the recruitment route that you would normally use off the shelf and land that in Kickstart, really giving it a little bit of thought about why am I involved in the programme? What do I want to get out of it for my business? But also, what can I give to the young person that's coming? We've found those vacancies are getting filled much, much quicker. The other thing I would say is that, you know, we will do absolutely everything we can to make those vacancies quality in conversation through our employer advisor network. So every new vacancy that's placed will have a named contact. That individual will work with the employer gateway to understand what's happening with their vacancy and to see whether there are different ways that we can get it filled. So, you know, come into the job centres, meet young people face to face, join our jobs fairs and our webinars, really try to promote those vacancies as widely as possible. So we will work individually with each employer and gateway as the vacancies land to agree the best and the quickest way of getting their jobs filled. Our aim is to turn this over as quickly as possible, but with the right quality of candidate.
Yeah, fantastic. That's superb. And on the back of that, really, that there is no reason why employers shouldn't be looking at this scheme. It's absolutely fantastic.
It is the best employment funded programme I have ever had the privilege of delivering for DWP. And the work coaches love it, and our customers are absolutely loving it. That they're surprised by this opportunity being there, but they're getting to get involved in all sorts of different career routes. So it's a very positive piece of the world to be in at the moment. So anybody who's interested, just let us know, and there will be somebody on this call that can help you.
Fantastic. Thank you so much for that. Wonderful. Right. So I'm going to just move on to Richard now. So Richard, a little bit about Kickstart as well, actually, but moving into another recently launched government scheme. Can you just talk us through and explain some of the differences between Kickstart and the Restart scheme, and perhaps what some employers can do to support in present climate?
Yeah, I'm conscious that Helene may want to add to this. You've had a good explanation about Kickstart already. The differences between the two. So Kickstart is young person specific. It's a job, and there's a very clear role for the employer within it. You are employing a young person on a placement for 6 months. Mm-hmm. Restart is a program for the long-term unemployed, all ages. And specifically those who have been unemployed for a period of 12 to 18 months. There's no set clear role for employers in it. However, the contracts, I think, specify. So I think the Serco have the contract. They are a prime provider for the West Midlands, and they will be going out trying to forge relationships with employers, seeing if there are opportunities for people who have come to them in that 12 to 18 month period. And we might expect that there'll be a significant number of young people on Restart who you may be approached through that. And there may be all sorts of different ideas, some familiar ideas, some new ones. And there's certainly a role for employers there. But that starts in July and will probably ramp up through next year. I think, as you heard today, Kickstart is the more immediate opportunity. And that's where I think attention should be focused now. The Prince's Trust is looking to be involved in both. We are involved in providing employability support for young people who engage in the Kickstart scheme, and we hope to be working with prime providers and employers through Restart as well.
Fabulous. That's lovely. Just to kind of follow up on that, and whilst we're talking about the different government schemes, obviously employers on the call will have heard of Kickstart. They'll have also heard of traineeships. So with that in mind, what would your suggestion be around choosing, essentially? You know, why should an employer go with Kickstart when there is the sort of traditionally established traineeships, for example?
It's probably, it depends on your business and what you're looking to, how you're looking to engage. Both are valuable schemes, which we hope can make a sort of life-changing difference for young people. There's a quite different scale. I mean, in traineeships, you're looking at providing work experience for at least, 70 hours is the minimum. And you're looking at £1,000 payment to do that. Whereas with Kickstart, you're looking at 6 months, which I'm not going to do the maths right now, but it's a lot more than 70 hours. So that young person is part of your business rather than being there for 70 hours on and off work experience. Mm. And I suppose you also get a significant, the money you receive through Kickstart, the wages are paid, 25 hours at minimum wage that comes to you, as well as a £1,500 on top to help with employability support. So traineeships are to help young people prepare for work. Kickstart is sort of a crisis response to get young people into employment when there's a lack of employment opportunities around. Yeah. So by all means, both are good. I think it depends on your business and to what, but there's a significant difference there in terms of the number of hours worked and the money provided.
Great stuff. That's fantastic. And again, for all these, just to reiterate the points that have already been made, I think this is lots of people on this call that you can connect through to hear more about all of these schemes. Wonderful. Thank you so much for that, Richard. Really appreciate it. So to move on to Louise, welcome. Nice to have you here. Question for you. If you can just talk us through a little bit about how has creating movement to work placements helped Marks and Spencer through the lens of diversity and inclusion?
Yeah, thanks, Simon. Hi, everybody. Inclusion and diversity is a real priority for us at M&S, and we really believe that employability programmes are key in bringing diverse talent into our business. Our programmes really support individuals from different backgrounds, all of whom bring different ideas, different skills into M&S. And with that, as we know, brings different thinking, and those different ideas really drive innovation. Bringing diversity into the business through our employability programmes also allows us to engage better with our customers, because obviously the individuals will, you know, be able to kind of really relate to the communities that we're operating in. A recent example that I thought I could just use to kind of bring this to life is, as you know, and Heather talked about, we've recently launched our Kickstart programme. And in our planning of Kickstart, we really considered how we could use Kickstart programme to, you know, make sure it was as inclusive, really diverse as possible. So with that in mind, we worked with our R&D team on how we could achieve this. So some of the things we did was think about the wording of our Kickstart advert to make sure it was inclusive as possible. We reviewed our recruitment materials, and we also asked our managers to complete mitigating bias training where we were doing the interviews for Kickstart. As a result, we've got a really diverse Kickstart cohort. So 22% were from ethnic minorities, 58% were female, and 8% have disabilities. So, you know, that was kind of a fantastic result and made sure that we had a really inclusive Kickstart programme. There's a really great diversity and inclusion analogy that I love, which I just kind of thought might be worth bringing to life.
So
diversity is all about being invited to the party. Inclusion is about being asked to dance at that party, whereas belonging is being asked to choose the music that you want to dance to. So I think the thing for us now is that we, you know, we've recruited that really diverse cohort for Kickstart, but the, you know, the real important part now is actually how do we make those young people feel really included in our stores and our teams, and how do they have that real sense of belonging? So we've been having quite a few ideas around that. So for example, line manager support, using our R&D networks, and also continuing with that line manager training.
Amazing. I'm going to steal that analogy at some point as well. That's fantastic. How do you just to follow up on that, how do you find that has impacted your current staff? Is it impacted them in a positive way?
Yeah, I think it's, you know, it's really enhanced our workforce, and, you know, Kickstart has been so positively received with our existing staff. And, you know, there's, I think, like Heather mentioned in her presentation, you know, our store teams are so supportive of our employability teams. And I think they're particularly seeing that kind of diversity come through. You know, for Kickstart, we've asked for stores to nominate buddies for every young person we've got. So for each store, we've got 6 young people, we've got 6 buddies. And I think, you know, the buddies get as much from these programmes as our young people do as well. So, yeah, really positive.
Wonderful. Fantastic. Thank you very much for that. I am definitely going to steal that analogy. So you heard it here first. I'm just conscious of the time. So what I'm going to do, I'm just going to go round the panel. It's a bit of an open question, so I'll let you fight amongst yourselves as to who answers first. But just in mind, obviously, the impact of the pandemic and how that's been felt across business and obviously through the young people community. What one piece of advice or key thought would you like to leave our audience today with, just as thinking around and sort of encouraging them to engage in youth employability programs, and, you know, what are those sort of key social business benefits on offer to those that choose to engage? So I'm going to let you fight it out because it's more fun. Whoever would like to go first?
Do you want me to go, Simon?
Yeah, go for it.
I think for me, employability programmes are just so important for a number of reasons. I think firstly, you know, for us as a business, playing a part in society to help those that need us most and giving them that chance that they wouldn't have otherwise had, and really help break down those barriers that, you know, that they're facing, and really then to help drive social mobility. I think then, you know, on top of that is just very much hearing the stories from individuals that have participated in those programs. And, you know, I think just when you hear those stories, and particularly the one we heard earlier from Hope about, you know, actually how these programs do transform lives and make such a difference, is just, you know, it always reminds me of why we do them. And then I suppose finally for me is, you know, I think Sam mentioned it at the start, but, you know, these programs do bring great talent into our business, and, you know, we really see individuals growing confidence and develop and progress their careers. And, you know, we've got individuals that joined through our programs that are now actually playing the buddy role or actually now team managers in our team. So it's really great to see that progression and that, that kind of confidence grow.
Wonderful. Thank you very much indeed, Louise. I will save you all, and I will come to Helene,
I was just going to say, the inspiration you need has come from the two videos that we've seen today. There is no doubt about that, that the impact that stepping in, leaning in, getting close to young people, you know, drawing the dots together for them is something that I think we all have a social responsibility for, whether you are a West Midlands resident like me or not. You know, this is about us giving back, making sure that our region comes back from the pandemic as quickly as it can. But also, I think there's a real time to turn the tide for our young people. There has never been a time when we've had so much support and opportunity out there. Let's make sure that our region gets the best of that. So, you know, I would encourage anybody who is a little bit, what are we doing? Is this right for us? Talk to Claire, talk to me, talk to Richard, talk to whoever. There is somebody in our region that can step forward and support your company in deciding what is the right route forward. And you know, it will bring great diversity, great future thinking, great skills into your business.
Wonderful. That's fantastic. Thank you so much. Richard, over to you, sir.
I'd just say, as it's Mental Health Awareness Week, I think this agenda isn't just about giving someone a job so that they're paid. There's a report out today from the Resolution Foundation which talks about sort of double jobs and mental health crisis, and those young people who are out of work and the increasing mental health problems they are experiencing. So by getting involved, perhaps not necessarily giving a job, but in any employability scheme to help those young people at the moment, can make a difference to mental health short term and long term.
Wonderful point. Absolutely. Absolutely. Okay. I think it's fitting if we come to Claire as the last respondent on today's panel. Claire, over to you.
Thank you. I think probably most of my panelists, colleagues have covered it, but I think the couple of bits for me was, think back to that video I showed you from Casey Bailey. And I think it is, what can we all do to help some of those acorns grow into oaks for all the reasons everybody's articulated, and I think we will only do it as Team West Midlands, you know, by pulling together, by believing in our region, by believing in our people, and making a difference for our region, for our future.
Wonderful, thank you so much. Right, that wraps up the panel discussion. It just leaves me to say thank you so much to Claire, Helene, Richard and Louise for your contributions. I mean, loads and loads of really inspirational things to think about and food for thought. With that, I will pass back over to Kathryn and say thank you very much.
Thanks, Simon, and thank you for chairing the panel today, and all our panellists as well for sharing your perspectives. I hope everyone that was listening took something from the conversation. If there's other questions and things that you have in the chat or information that you want, just pop that in there. I'd certainly love to see the link for that Resolution Foundation report, Richard. If you've got that to hand, that'd be great. You know, and do engage with us at Movement to Work if you want to have any ongoing conversations about the topics we've talked about today. So now I'm going to hand back to our Movement to Work CEO, Sam Olsen. She's going to give us some closing thoughts as well. So Sam, back over to you.
Thank you. And thank you so much to the panelists there. So, Kathryn, you've done a great job of keeping us to track. I've really enjoyed the session so far today and really hope it's given everyone a bit of food for thought and some things to take away. Happy to share those videos at another time as well if you need that ongoing inspiration. So I've got a few more things for you to think about now before you leave. But first of all, huge thank you to the West Midlands Combined Authority for their support in promoting this event in the region, to our speakers, Claire, Helene, Richard, Louise and Heather, and also to, as we said, the newly elected Mayor, Andy Street, for joining us and sharing that really on-message support about why this is the moment for us to all pull together. So much of what we do at Movement to Work is about the power of collaboration and sharing knowledge. And these events become the real proof of that, don't they? So that you all hopefully take some time and energy from this to think about your next steps. In terms of the Midlands specifically, I mentioned it's where I went to school, it's where my first jobs began, which I think is why I'm so excited about the work we're planning on doing with Birmingham 2022 Commonwealth Games. The volunteering and work experience opportunities that this will generate in the region is huge. And we have a responsibility as employers to really ensure that those opportunities are available and encouraged to those young people furthest from the labour market. Happier times are ahead with the volunteering window opening as early as next month. And I think it'll be a fantastic pathway into employment post games. I also wanted to give you a couple of updates of things that we're working on at Movement to Work at the moment. One of them is that we've been working with the wonderful people over at Youth Employment UK on a joint kickstart guide for employers that's really worth a read and worth sharing with your networks. As well as a quick overview, it provides you with access to a database of approved partners, including our partners, the Prince's Trust, who can help you to succeed with Kickstart. Hopefully, by the magic of a virtual event, somebody will be sharing a link to it in the chat, and you can download it for later. Linking to this, I'm trying to remember the words that Andy used, but there's a lot of different programs and options out there. I'm not going to share the slide where we tried to map it today, but to say it looks like a tin of spaghetti is an understatement. When you're looking at government-funded schemes and how best to approach this, we're really conscious that it's a messy and a complex world. So it's with thanks to Accenture that we've compiled an employer toolkit, which will provide you with a comprehensive overview of all the various routes and associated government-funded schemes for youth employability programmes. We know that it's sometimes quite overwhelming, and actually what's right for Marks and Spencers isn't right for Barclays, isn't right for Accenture, is what we've learnt. But having a clear, simple pathway through them all is what we are able to support you with. So lots of things going on at Movement to Work, but the third one I want to share with you is that later in the year, we're going to be publishing a piece of research which seeks to uncover the ways in which employers engage in youth employment programmes. What the business benefits are and also what the barriers are. What is it that's preventing employers from doing more in this space? We really hope the research will give us lots of interesting insights that we can use to refine our approach and further support all of you in the right ways. And a huge thanks to our partners, Sage, Accenture, Youth Futures and IFF, who are collaborating with us in this space. So those are the quick updates. Now some thoughts that I'd like to leave you with. Firstly, so many of you come to talk to us about youth employability programmes through a CSR lens, and then you move into, actually, this is a HR opportunity. We've had some really great conversations recently about seeing the work we do in a much broader context. So bear with me for the number of acronyms coming up, but we've got CSR, we've got ESGs, we've got SDGs. Collectively, we've been considering our mission in light of those broader sustainability goals, which businesses are increasingly engaged with. We know that you have demands from senior stakeholders and customers in order to be able to report on them. And what's becoming clear is that whilst creating youth employment programmes is a great thing to do from a diversity talent perspective, being involved in Movement to Work is actually a fantastic way to engage with sustainability in a way that's meaningful. Enabling young people in your communities to thrive has huge societal impacts. So please don't underestimate the power of the work that you can do and the impact it will have on your society and your communities. Secondly, please continue to think creatively and outside the box. We've seen great examples of this over the last 12 months, in particularly around moving to virtual and hybrid work experience. Our young people have faced a huge amount of trauma and disruption over the last 12 months. We all have, but we know that it's young people who've been disproportionately affected. We need to really inspire our young people to trust us again. We really need to excite our young people that there is a brighter future on offer. And I challenge you all to really think about what you're offering and the way that you're offering it. So let's take an example. The job opportunities that you create for young people, are they really landing well? What language are you using? Do you write them in the same way as you appeal to somebody with 2, 3, 10 years experience? Where are you promoting it? Is this something that a young person is really going to get excited about? Also, what youth insight have you got within your own organisations and how can that help you? Another example is that rather than recruiting to an ever decreasing pool of experienced candidates, can you change your criteria and convert an existing team member to a mentor, helping to upskill young recruits who don't have the experience yet, but could get it quite quickly with the right help? I had a really interesting conversation with somebody in hospitality the last couple of weeks who was saying, but I just can't get people with 1 to 2 years experience. And I'm saying, but your business has been closed. Your sector has been closed for a year. How are you going to do this? We've got to think differently, got to think creatively. So as part of this, I'm going to repeat something I say quite often, and we all need to remember that as leaders, we are part of this problem. If we continue to recruit the same way, we're contributing to making the world of work that bit harder for young people to enter. In the same way, you all have the power in this virtual room to be a catalyst for positive change in your organisations. You have the power to change a young person's life, to give them that chance they need to lift them out of depression, to feed their families, to break a cycle of generational poverty. So be bold, be open, and take a chance on someone. Do not underestimate the power you have to really make things change for the better. So lastly, I suppose something I want to leave you with is, you're not alone in this effort. We are here to help you. We know it's a complicated landscape. We are fully funded by our steering group to simply help businesses to do more in this space. So tell your colleagues about us and get them to drop us a line. We're simply here to find ways to help you so that you can help more young people. Let us know what barriers you're facing and let us help you to find and overcome them. Thank you so much for your time today. And I'm really hoping that the next time we manage to talk to you at the back end of the year, I can actually offer you that coffee and maybe a nice little pastry. We've got to hope. On that comment, last comment, Kathryn, I think I'm handing back over to you.
Thanks, Sam. That's great. And thank you for those really inspiring words. And thank you for everybody that's taken time to attend today. We're really passionate about making an impact in the West Midlands. So please do get in touch with us if we can help you navigate this complex landscape. You can drop us an email at info@movementtowork.com or reach out to any of the team directly. So you'll have seen a link has been dropped in the chat. We'd love to get your feedback as we move towards the back end of the session. So please take a moment to just complete our short survey. This will really help us work out what went well, what could go better, because we are already looking ahead to our next leadership forum in the summer months, and we'd love to make that event even better. And so there's the link there to pop your details on. Also, we're really passionate to amplify what we do and get our reach as big as possible. So if you're not already following our social media channels, please do so. There's a number that we use: LinkedIn, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, etc. We love you to also share what your thoughts were about the event today. Get that out there in your personal social media channels as well to really reach out and get those messages of help and support out to employers and businesses that we're here to help support them, help tackle youth unemployment. So we'd love to hear from you. Please do keep engaged with us. And just to say thank you so much for your time today. We've really enjoyed having everybody with us today. And hopefully you've been inspired to go forward and take action in your organisations. So thank you, and hope you have a great day.